Welcome back, I'm that chemist, and today we have five important papers in organic synthesis for the month of August. So the first paper for today is the convenient synthesis of carbenes from aldehydes. This was done by David Nagib's group, and some of the highlights of this paper include the use of aldehydes as carbene precursors through the intermediacy of geminal haloester intermediates. Normally, when people are generating carbenes, it'll be done via the Simmons-Smith, the Corey-Tchaikovsky, or through diazo intermediates. They also take these carbenes and dimerize them to form alkenes. They also show that these carbenes can be used for most of the typical reactions carbenes can do, including the addition to amines and so on, as well as the addition into alkenes, carbonyls, and imines, just the typical reactions you'd expect of carbenes. It also addresses the issue of diazo compound instability, as these compounds are much more stable than the diazo compounds. So I'm not going to be going too much into scope this time because they do a lot of different chemistry in this paper, and if you're interested in seeing some of that chemistry, I'd encourage you to go check it out. The main thing that they do in this paper that I want to highlight is the use of aldehydes. So with a zinc catalyst, just using something like zinc chloride or zinc bromide in the presence of an acyl halide, they're able to convert an aldehyde into a geminal haloester species. In the case of benzaldehydes, they use pivoloyl chloride in the presence of zinc chloride. In the case of aliphatic aldehydes, they tend to use benzoyl bromide. And if you wanted to add a methyl group, they'll use benzoyl iodide, although the reagent prepared using benzoyl aldehyde and formaldehyde is also commercially available. So once they form this geminal haloester species, they're able to treat it with various transition metals to get different modes of reactivities as carbenoids. It's also worth noting that this reaction's been known for quite some time, but there's very few groups who utilize it. Now, the overview of this reaction is as follows. First, you get your aldehyde, you generate your intermediate, and you can form your metal carbenoid, and then you can do various insertions. This compares with, for instance, diiodomethane, which is used for the Simmons-Smith cyclopropanation reaction, or diazo compounds, which are another really common precursor to carbenes. The other advantage here is you can use non-stabilized carbene precursors, whereas a lot of the existing ones require stabilized carbene precursors, so you're limited in terms of what types of carbenes you can install. Here you can see what I summarized on the last slide, where aliphatic aldehydes are treated with benzoyl bromide, benzaldehydes are treated with pivoloyl chloride, and formaldehyde is treated with benzoyl iodide. So some of the highlights of this paper. Here you can see that when they treat this gem haloester species with zinc, they form a zinc carbenoid, and this will just undergo protodechlorination. Although if they treat this with elemental manganese, this will undergo a radical pathway and does pinnacle-type coupling. And once this dimer is formed, they aren't able to eliminate to form stilbene under the typical reaction conditions. Additionally, it's worth noting that when they form this carbenoid species, they could get selective reactivity depending on whether or not dimethyl sulfide was added. So when they add dimethyl sulfide, they get polarity inversion. So in this case where they just have their iron carbenoid, they can do cyclopropanation to this methyl styrene. Although once they've added dimethyl sulfide, because the sulfonium illit is formed, they're able to do addition to electron poor alkenes. So this is a useful trick. If they need to invert the selectivity of the carbenoid, they can add in dimethyl sulfide and this will accomplish that transformation. Another example of this is shown here. When dimethyl sulfide is absent, they get a cyclopropanation type product, although when they add dimethyl sulfide, they're able to do an addition into this aldehyde to give this epoxide type product through a Corey-Tchaikovsky reaction. Here you can see that they highlight the thermal stability of these reagents compared to diazo compounds. You can see that there's almost no thermal energy released when these decompose, and their onset temperatures are extremely high, whereas diazo compounds release a lot of energy and their detonation temperatures are much lower. They highlight a lot more of these reactions in their paper, and I'd encourage you to go check it out. It's a really good paper, and I really hope that we get to see more people use this type of carbene precursor moving forward. Now, the next paper for today is the hydroboration of inones. This is a paper I like quite a bit, although I am a sucker for boron chemistry. One of the highlights of this paper is that it forms a carbon-boron bond, and it reduces the corresponding inones to allylic alcohols in the process, forming a tertiary boron species. It also enables the installation of a versatile B-pin group, which they demonstrate can subsequently be converted into several other analogs. Another highlight of this paper is that it demonstrates good functional group compatibility. So this paper has a decent scope, as you can see here, esters, mesylates, TBS-protected alcohols, thalamides, and several other interesting groups were all well tolerated. You can see that there's several groups here that might potentially get reduced by that pinnacle borane, and so the fact that those are tolerated is quite good. Once they make this product, they're able to do several different types of chemistry. Here you can see the alkene is selectively reduced. Alternatively here, a beta bromination is done, also converting this back to a ketone. Here you can see the hydroxy group's been reduced under mild conditions. Additionally, they can protect it, and they can also substitute the alcohol with the methyl group using methyl chloroformate in the presence of methyl lithium, which is kind of a cool reaction. This is a simplified version of the mechanism. If you'd like to see their DFT studies, I'd encourage you to go read their paper. But in this mechanism, you can see the first hydride is delivered to the beta position through the formation of an alene intermediate. This alene is then hydroborated a second time, delivering a hydride to the alpha position and the boron to the ipso carbon. and upon workup, this OB pin group is deprotected, affording the alcohol. So overall, this is quite a cool paper, and it's interesting to see an inversion of the typical reactivity you would expect, where carbonyls might be reduced to the O boron species, but in this case, you can see that the carbon forms a C boron species. And so this is quite a nice paper. The third paper for today is the oxidative cleavage of alkenes with nitroarenes. The highlights of this paper include an appealing alternative to ozonolysis, which would be the typical set of conditions for oxidative cleavage. This also complements Lemieux-Johnson oxidation, which is just dihydroxylation with ozonolysis and pyridate cleavage. And I've also made a video on Lemieux-Johnson oxidation in the past, and I'll include a link to that in the description. Here you can see that a nitroarene is used instead as their oxidant. So they use this under photochemical conditions to cleave alkenes, and this works best for styrenes, but it also provides some conversion for unactivated alkenes. Now, while this doesn't work as well for aliphatic alkenes, as I'm going to mention later, there's an upcoming paper from Leonori's group which addresses this issue. They also have decent functional group tolerance overall in their scope. So some highlights of their scope are shown here. Here you can see that there's some styrene derivatives, some interesting functional groups were well tolerated, such as the cyclopropane. Here you can see that we have this electron-rich double bond, which was tolerated, and instead the styrene was preferred. There's other groups which might potentially get cleaved by something like ozone, but were tolerated in this case. And here you can see the aliphatic examples. The aliphatic examples have lower yields. Now that being said, it's important to remember that ozone would also be really harsh and often give terrible yields for some complex examples. So I think overall this is still quite a cool methodology, and it'll be interesting to see moving forward if this type of chemistry gets adopted. As I was saying before, Leonori's group has a similar paper which is currently under review. If you'd like to see it ahead of time, it's present on a preprint server which I'll include a link to in the description, and their methodology seems to address this issue a little bit more. Similar conditions, similar idea. It just so happens that this paper beat them to the punch. Make sure you stay tuned for a future episode where that paper will definitely be featured. Now, the mechanism of this paper is really interesting. There's this cool technique that I want to highlight, which utilizes an NMR light probe. So you can essentially have a fiber optic cable, which just goes into your NMR. And this is a commercially available product. You can get it from various vendors that I'm not going to name. These products can allow you to study photochemical reactions on an NMR timescale, including variable temperature NMR. So you can imagine some really creative ways to monitor reactions using this technique. In this portion of the paper, they demonstrate some trapping products that kind of illustrate the mechanism. Here you can see that this intermediate was treated with hydrogen and they were afforded with this 1,2-diol. Additionally, they got some mechanistic evidence as shown here where they form the cycloaddition product, they form the benzaldehyde, as well as this activated carbonyl species. This activated carbonyl species is able to recombine with the benzaldehyde and then undergo polar cleavage to afford this imine oxide. And this imine oxide is then able to form an oxaziridine, which can rearrange forming this amide, which would be a side product of the reaction. So their overall proposed mechanism is as follows. The nitroarene is able to be photochemically excited, forming this diradical species, which can then react with this alkene to form a carbon-centered radical. This carbon radical can recombine with this oxygen radical, forming this five-membered ring. This five-membered ring can undergo polar fragmentation to afford one of two different aldehydes, which can rearrange to form one of two five-membered ring species. And depending on which one forms, you'll get a different aldehyde. And so one of the things that they do is they utilize different nitroarenes in their supplemental information, where you can see essentially a nitrobenzene with an electron withdrawing group in the para position is preferred, although the one that they highlight in their paper tends to be 4-cyanonitrobenzene. Overall, I think that this is a really cool paper, and it'll be exciting to see if this gets utilized in total syntheses moving forward. The fourth paper for today is the synthesis of pleurodin. Some highlights of this paper include the formal synthesis of pleurodin, lots of good uses of organic chemistry, which is really creative, and the key step is the photocatalytic CH epimerization, which is illustrated here. Now, some of the cool reactions in this paper that I really appreciated are shown here. Now, if you want to see more reactions from this paper, I'd encourage you to go read the paper itself, because it's got some other really cool chemistry that I didn't have time to feature here. One of the steps that they do is reduce this ester to the corresponding alkoxide, and then they do a modified birch reduction under ammonia-free conditions to get this birch intermediate. And then they quench the crude with 6 molar hydrochloric acid, and that ends up decomposing this methyl vinyl ether to the corresponding ketone. So I really like this strategy. It might be a little bit counterintuitive to start with this compound and end with this compound here, so I really like that creative approach on their part. Very cool. Another reaction that I really liked was this intermolecular Diels-Alder reaction between this compound shown here. The methyl group and the carbonyl are the two double bonds. They generate this diene through photoexcitation, and they use titanium as a Lewis acid to help direct the diastereoselectivity of this reaction. So here you can see the structure of their major product. The one issue here is that they need to invert stereocenter 11 so that it's pointing down instead of up. So that's why they have this NHPI ether derivative. This NHPI ether derivative is able to form an oxygen-centered radical under photocatalytic conditions. Once this oxygen-centered radical is generated, it abstracts the proton. So to get the desired product that they wanted, they had to screen thiols, and they found that a really bulky thiol would favor the diastereomer that they wanted, diastereomer 8. If you're interested in hearing more about that, I encourage you to go read the paper. Overall, I thought this was a really cool synthesis, and I really like this use of photoredox chemistry to generate this final product and use a hydrogen atom transfer strategy. I really like seeing this type of work, especially the use of thiols as trapping agents. Really nice to see. Now, the fifth paper for today is the synthesis of enynes from inones. Some highlights of this paper include silver doing some unexpected chemistry, seemingly serendipitous, in their earlier work making furans. When their R1 group was an aromatic group, they tended to get furans. They had screened different groups where this position with two electron withdrawing groups is, and they found when they had two electron withdrawing groups instead of something else like an oxygen or whatever, that they would instead get this reaction. So this is something that they discovered during their work on another project. I think that this reaction is pretty cool, and it may inform some new reaction discovery, because silver does a lot of neat chemistry that often gets overlooked, and people use silver to just drive SN2 reactions to completions quite often, so hopefully this will inspire some new chemistry. I think these products are also kind of cool, and this reaction itself is rather unexpected. So the scope of this reaction is relatively good. They have relatively low silver loading, which I thought was nice. In addition to having diester groups in this position, they can also have other electron withdrawing groups in addition to one ester, which ends up getting removed in the product. Here you can see a nitrile, a sulfone, as well as ketones were all tolerated, although they were only able to form cyclohexenes, not cycloheptenes. They also demonstrated that because DBU can promote the Michael addition of these 1,3 electron deficient dicarbonyl or related species to Michael acceptors, that they could just do this all in one pot and get the same sort of product, because the DBU is a catalyst in that Michael addition and it's also needed for the next step. So this is a clever thing on their part. So they did this one pot procedure to show that this is a useful reaction and you don't need to pre-isolate the intermediates. The mechanism for this reaction is a little bit unexpected. So the first step is silver coordinates to that alkyne and you can form a silver acetylide really easily. Silver likes to coordinate to alkynes, this reaction's facile. This is then able to form an allenyl silver species, which can then undergo intramolecular attack on this carbonyl, forming a silver alkoxide as well as reforming the alkyne. Once a silver alkoxide is formed, it's able to undergo an intramolecular attack, forming a lactone, and DBU is able to eliminate this lactone through deprotonation of the alpha position relative to the alkyne. This forms the cyclohexene, and it also forms CO2 as a leaving group, as well as a silver enolate. The silver enolate is able to be protonated by the DBU base, forming the product. So definitely an unexpected reaction. To see the loss of an ester group just through the presence of silver was pretty surprising for me, and I think that these products could be really useful. Definitely an interesting transformation, and I hope to see this chemistry utilized. Now the honorable mentions for this month are as follows: alkynyl trifluoroborate alkylation in Orglet, dearomative silylation of arenes from JOC, vinilligous and bisvinilligous propargylic substitution from JEX. We also had the synthesis of perfluorocubane this month, and this almost made it as a cutoff of one of the five papers, but because I focus on synthetic utility in this series, I thought it would be appropriate to include it here and not as one of the main papers, although I love a good cubane, as many of the members of the chemistry community do. We also had an example of Aza Bayer-Villiger oxidation in Orglet. We had another really cool total synthesis in JAX, which I'd encourage you to check out. We saw another good paper from Gary Molander's group forming B-pin BCPs from NHPI esters and B2-pin-2. This is a cool paper and you should check it out. I already included a relatively similar one last month, but I'd encourage you to go check this one out anyway. We also had this paper where they have like a million examples of amination of aryl halides under photocatalytic conditions with nickel, and this is a cool paper. This really seems like a general approach that complements Buchwald-Hartwig amination, and I'd encourage you to check that out, especially if you're forming any aromatic amine derivatives. So hopefully you've enjoyed this episode. If you ever have any suggestions, you're welcome to submit them in the Discord or DM me on Twitter. I hope that you enjoy this series, and I hope you have a great day.